Does having low cholesterol harm the brain? Is it bad for the brain? This is a common question, and the logic goes something like, well, the brain needs cholesterol, the brain contains a lot of cholesterol, so do I need to keep my cholesterol level in the blood high to fuel the brain? So I think a key realization here is that the brain produces its own cholesterol. It's a separate pool from the blood. In the blood, cholesterol is carried by these little packages called lipoproteins, and those essentially don't cross the blood-brain barrier, this barrier between the blood and the brain, as the name indicates. So the pool of cholesterol in the brain that the brain produces, it's a separate pool. The brain does not need the cholesterol from the blood. So someone who has cholesterol naturally low, whether it's genetics or healthy lifestyle, there's no reason to worry about that. But there is a kink here. People who are on lipid-lowering medication, so drugs that lower cholesterol, the lowering of the cholesterol level in the blood, as we said, shouldn't be a problem. But if those drugs reduce the production of cholesterol in the brain, then that could cause issues. So this is a really common question, and I think it's a really good question. And the realization here is that we want to rely on scientific tests and scientific evidence to answer these questions, because stories, basically, we can spin stories in any direction we want. Story number one, statins lower cholesterol in the brain, so they cause dementia. Story number two, statins help unclog the arteries that take blood up to the brain, so they prevent dementia. Both plausible stories, so how do we know which one is true? Or maybe neither is true. This is why in science, we measure and we test. So what happens to people who have their cholesterol lowered with drugs, for example? What happens to their cognitive function, to their memory, to their risk of dementia? By the way, I have zero relationship with pharmaceutical industry or any other industry. Don't care what happens to them financially one way or another. And I'm on a statin myself, started about a year ago. Not for cholesterol. I keep my cholesterol and my ApoB pretty low with lifestyle. I take it for LPA, which is this other lipoprotein. We can talk more about that if there's interest. But the point here is I care deeply about the answer to these questions, which is exactly why I try to look at the most accurate, the most reliable sources of information. So we have tons of studies on this. This has been studied dozens and dozens of times. So for example, one systematic review and meta-analysis looked at 16 studies put together, and they concluded that in patients who don't already have a cognitive dysfunction before starting the drug, the short-term data are most compatible with no adverse effect of statins on cognition, and the long-term data might actually support a beneficial role for statins in prevention of dementia. Another systematic review published a couple years later went over 25 randomized controlled trials and concluded statin therapy was not associated with cognitive impairment in randomized controlled trials, and they included both cognitively normal and Alzheimer's disease patients. So overall, and I've gone over dozens of these studies and these systematic reviews, in randomized trials in the aggregate, we don't see much of an effect of statins on cognitive function or risk of dementia, risk of Alzheimer's. In prospective cohort studies, which are longer, the longest one I've seen was about 25 years follow-up, but they have different limitations. And in those, generally what we see in the aggregate is an inverse correlation, so a lower risk of dementia and Alzheimer's. In terms of funding, which is a common question, the randomized trials tend to be funded by the pharmaceutical industry, and the observational studies tend to not be funded by pharma. In general, my approach is an isolated study, something that's seen once, has little weight, regardless of who funded it. What I want to see is a consistent direction of effect over 10, 20, 30 different studies, and that largely gets over these concerns about funding or bias or outliers. So that's a quick summary of the evidence out there on statins and cognitive function. Now, there are studies looking at other cholesterol-lowering medication, not statins. For example, these drugs called PCSK9 inhibitors, which also lower cholesterol, lower ApoB, lower risk of heart disease. So what is this thing and how do they work? So cholesterol travels in our blood in lipoproteins, as we said, and these are removed from circulation by our liver. So in the liver, there's a little docking station called LDL receptor. So these lipoproteins can bind to that and be removed. Statins block the cholesterol production in the liver, so the liver is short of cholesterol. It tries to get more cholesterol from the blood, from lipoproteins. And it does that by making more of these docking stations. So more lipoproteins get removed from the blood, and the risk of heart disease goes down. These PCSK9 inhibitors, these other drugs, they work similarly at the end of the day. They cause more docking stations to be active. So the end result is the same. So in some patients who have very high risk, for example, if they've had a heart attack before, and now we're trying to prevent a second heart attack, so we call this secondary prevention. These people have very high risk, so sometimes they're on combined treatment. They're on a statin, and on top of that, they're on a PCSK9 inhibitor. And what happens often is their cholesterol level is very, very low, often under 50 milligrams per deciliter. And for reference, 100 is the usual medical threshold. Under 100 is considered normal. Average in the U.S. is about 120, give or take. Mine hovers around 70 or 80 naturally with lifestyle without medication. So these guys are under 50. So it's a very low, unusual level. So it's a very interesting population to study, because if lowering cholesterol in the blood causes problems in the brain, then we might see it here first, since they have such low levels. Now, compared to statins, this is actually a bit less of a concern, because the data we have, PCSK9 inhibitors don't seem to cross the blood-brain barrier, but still interesting to study and look at what happens. So scientists studied patients on these drugs as well, followed them over time, ran a battery of cognitive tests, memory tests, visual tests, different puzzles and exercises. So we have, for example, two randomized trials where patients are on a statin and then they're split randomly. Half goes on a PCSK9 inhibitor in addition to the statin. The other half gets the placebo on top of the statin. And so two randomized trials have done this with two different drugs, two types of PCSK9 inhibitor. And essentially they found no significant difference on cognitive function of this PCSK9 inhibitor compared to the placebo. That's good to know. Problem is, these trials are very short. They're usually 1 to 2 years. So good to know there are no issues in that time frame, but maybe issues arise later. So a study just came out, which is an extension of these trials, where they kept following the participants for an additional 5 years after the trial. So total follow-up of about 7 years. And what they did was, the trial is over and they offer the possibility to all the participants of going on the PCSK9 inhibitor, and the vast majority took it. So they're looking at people who are on a statin plus a PCSK9 inhibitor, and so they have very low cholesterol level. The median for the entire group was 35 milligrams per deciliter, and a third of the participants were actually under 25. So exceptionally low cholesterol levels. And the bottom line is, they didn't find any significant decline in any of the battery of cognitive tests that they ran. And they even divided these participants by the level of cholesterol achieved. And even the ones that were on the lowest category, those that were under 25 milligrams per deciliter, even in those guys, they didn't see any significant decline in any of the cognitive tests. So 7 years, better than 1.5, 2 years, more informative. It's not 20 years, so we can always raise the bar, and we should always ask more stringent questions. As far as very long follow-ups, the longest I've seen, as I said, is for statins for 20-something years, the prospective cohorts, but those are not randomized trials, so they have their own set of limitations. So this is always going to be an informed decision for each person to make with their healthcare practitioner. There is no right and wrong universally here. The right decision for one person might be the wrong decision for the next guy. I actually think that most people can be very healthy and avoid heart disease in the first place without medication, just naturally, especially if they have good genetics and if they start early enough in life that they preempt the issue. The meds are really helpful for people whose genetics have some kinks, like people with familial hypercholesterolemia, FH, other genetic causes of very high cholesterol, for example, people with LPA. That's my case, it runs in my family. So it's an option for these cases. Also for people who didn't play their cards right early in life, didn't know about it perhaps, and develop the disease and have advanced cardiovascular disease, who've had a heart attack, who have a lot of plaque, who have high calcium score, in those cases, medication can be really helpful, lowering the risk as much as possible. And it's always in addition to, medication does not replace lifestyle. This is important to clarify. Lifestyle is always first line of attack. And then for people who need it, you add the medication on top. So my personal thought process was, I went over as much evidence as I could. Like I said, stories like the brain needs cholesterol, that means nothing to me. I want to see actual tests, actual data. And looking at these studies individually and kind of going over it systematically, there's some heterogeneity, there's some outliers. But when I look at this, these systematic reviews, these meta-analyses, and when I go through this in kind of a organized fashion, there's a pretty consistent balance of evidence pointing to safety and even a suggestion of benefit there, possibly. So I'm quite comfortable with this balance of evidence. But that's not necessarily going to be the right decision for everyone. Now, there's also personal accounts, stories of people who say, hey, I started taking a statin or some lipid-lowering medication, and I got fuzziness, I got memory issues. And I think we have to be very respectful of those stories, and I think we have to be open to the possibility that there's an issue there. We also have to be very cautious with anecdotes, because it's incredibly difficult to establish cause and effect from anecdotes. I know someone who started a statin and got a memory issue, was diagnosed with Alzheimer's a year later. Okay, but most people who start statins tend to be of a certain age, and we know that a percentage of those people are going to have these issues, are going to have Alzheimer's. So what I need to know, what I want to know, is the rate. What is the rate of these problems in that population without the statin versus with the statin? And is this number higher or lower? This is why it's crucial to look at data sets and look at statistics, because we can find stories in any direction we want. I'm actually quite open to the possibility that statins cause memory issues or cognitive issues in some individuals. We have, for example, some individual reports of what we call a rechallenge. So the person says, I started the statin, I got the fuzziness, I stopped the statin, it went away, I started it again, that's the rechallenge, and it came back. So I'm open to that possibility. In these situations, scientifically, we have to worry about something called the nocebo effect, which is kind of the cousin of the placebo effect, where we are worried about a drug or a food or something having a harmful effect on us, and so we tend to attribute feelings to it, even if they sometimes are not caused by that food or drug. So this is always a possibility. This has been shown. It's a thing. So we have to be careful about that. But I am completely open to the possibility that in some individuals, statins may cause cognitive issues or memory issues or this fuzziness. It seems unusual. It seems statistically uncommon because it doesn't pop up in these large studies looking at thousands of people. If it was something very common, if it affected a large chunk of the population, we'd see a signal of harm, and we consistently don't. So maybe in a very specific population with some special susceptibility, maybe it happens there. I'm completely open to that. Usually the story is that the person felt these things and then they stopped the statin and it went away. So my thought process was, I'll try it. And if it happens to me, in the unlikely event that it happens to be me with the susceptibility, then I'll try stopping it. I noticed no changes whatsoever to attention or cognitively or memory, completely unchanged. What was I talking about again? No, just kidding. I also didn't experience any muscle pains, which people often ask about and some people report. So, as always, this is case by case. Some people are intolerant to statins and some people experience no side effects. So we have to give people this information so they can make informed decisions. The problem is, on social media, these things tend to be very emotional and very artificially polarized. You'll hear one side say, statins are this perfect thing and they should be in the water supply. And then the other side will say it's poison, it's killing everyone. This is not serious. It's not a scientific discussion. It's not going to allow people to make an informed decision. So that was my thought process, and that's where I'm at. Maybe your personal strategy is completely different, and that's just as valid for you. I just recommend that people learn about these things and what science exists, because the hot takes on social media are all over the place. For more information on statins and risk of death, do statins prolong life? Do they shorten life? By how much? We have a whole video going over that in detail. Check that out right here. And for tips on how to lower your cholesterol and your ApoB naturally with lifestyle, with diet, we have a whole video on that. Check it out right here. I'll meet you in there. Take care.